Hello, and welcome to Let's Read the Books of Enderal. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Today I'll be reading The Butcher of Ark, Volume 8, Masks, which I found in Grave Caves, and I'm here at the Dancing Nomad. Chapter 8, Masks. 3 months passed before Kalian considered me worthy of performing the ritual which would make me a full-fledged brother of the Black Libra. He asked if I really wanted to take the path now that I was aware of its true nature. The fact that I stayed was answer enough. After all, what else should I have done? I had fled from an undefined fear, leaving my old life in order to find out where it came from. As absurd as it might sound to you, I had the feeling that I had found the right path in Kalian and the fire. "We are born as servants of the Libra," he had told me one evening, "but it is up to us to discover our purpose." He himself was the son of a nobleman, he had confided in me, although, unlike me, he remembered the first years of his life. He had always had the vague sense that he was destined to be someone different. In his mind, too, something had been hidden which he was unable to explain, and he had also experienced these fleeting moments during which this something crossed the threshold into his consciousness. His first cleansing had been a crucial experience. An assassin had been hired by a hostile family to seek revenge. She had been disguised as a maid and had entered his rooms, but he had seen through the disguise and defeated the hired murderer. The nectar of her sins had been the first step for him. He would not tell me what other obstacles had awaited him after this moment. I only knew that I was about to overcome one. I did not mind the uncertainty during the long wait. I learned a lot, and for the first time in my life, I felt like someone special. How foolish all the people on the street seemed to me. Full of ignorance, they lived their ordinary lives, prayed to the gods, and believed that abidance to the path and godliness alone were enough to protect them from the abyss. Alas, how deluded they were! There was no higher power to free us from the responsibility to protect us from sin. We alone decided what we gave into, and when we acted weakly. "People do not want to carry responsibility for themselves, my friend," Kalian had said to me one time. "They never have." More and more I began to view the world as a game board. The stars, nature, or gods foreign to us had set the rules, and now delightfully observed how mankind struggled to cope. Maybe they had the power to remove temptation and sin from the world? I did not know. Nevertheless, evil was not supposed to get the upper hand, and that was why we were who we were. It was uplifting to be a sighted man among the blind. So many times in my old life I had felt powerless, angry about how little justice I found in our world. How many times, even in my small village, I had seen a guilty, sinful man avoid his just punishment because of status, prestige, or gold, while a vagrant got thrown into the dungeon for stealing a chicken. These events embittered me, but I used to assume that this was simply the way of the world. The Black Libra, however, had changed everything, and the thought of being part of it filled me with such triumph and euphoria I could scarcely contain it. Had this been the reason for my anxiety? That I, Jael Tennerson, had always sensed my true destiny, to bring justice to the world? Even now, after I have realized the insanity of the Libra, I cannot answer the question. I just know that it felt right back then. As opposed to what you may think, we brothers of the Libra did not choose our victims arbitrarily. When a corrupted was responsible for too many sins, the member chosen for the killing was informed about the mission via letter. I never understood how these letters always found their destination, regardless of location and circumstances. They contained only two pieces of information, a drawing of the damned, likeness, and a name. The rest, collecting further information and planning the assassination, was the Chosen's task. Before my trial, Kalian received four such letters, and I witnessed three of the killings. You might wonder about the casualness with which I write about it, but as I said, there is almost no situation the human mind will not adapt to. I adapted to the cleansings. They were always justified, however cruel they appeared. All the people we killed were corrupted and had managed to evade justice with wealth or cunning. but they could not evade us. The Libra was older than Enderal, the Lightborn, perhaps even the Tides. Nobody knew which prince, god, or shapeless entity pulled the strings, and nobody knew how the chosen ones differed from the common people. Even if I had been able to, I would never have investigated the matter. I did not care why I had met Kalian, and where the strange vision had its origin. With the fire in my blood, I was not just anyone anymore. I was special. That was exactly what I felt when I sat next to Kalian in a carriage 3 moons later. The time had come. I had been told. I was worthy now. Worthy. I wanted to look out of the window, but I was reminded that the glass was veiled by black cloth. No beam of light entered the cabin. Only a lantern on the ceiling emitted some light. "You'll have to get used to this," Kalian said. "Even I don't know the locations of the bastions."
"Bastions?"
"The strongholds. They are temples. There's one on each continent, but nobody knows where they are." I nodded. "If I were a spy, I'd be able to blow the cover."
"You wouldn't," Kalian responded. "The Black Libra can be shattered as much as a forbidden thought can be erased. It's impossible. You can prohibit it by law, you can burn writings about it, but it will never vanish. This trial is not about your loyalty," he continued. "If you weren't loyal, I would have killed you long ago."
"What is it about, then?"
"About limits." He paused a moment, as if he were sorting his words in the right order to give me just enough information. "You may believe that you have already crossed them, but you haven't. Deep inside," he pointed between my eyes with his index finger, "they still exist. We who have fully committed ourselves to the Libra, we are different than other people, Jael."
I nodded. "The fire."
"Yes, the fire. But don't be mistaken. You don't know everything about it. You have been guided by its force. You feel its voice inside of you. And you have tasted the sins of the obsessed ones. However, this is only a part of what constitutes a true servant of the Libra." My stomach itched, as if the fire approved of Kalian's words. His words resounded in my mind. I realized I was still separated by miles from my comrade and mentor. Aside from the obvious, his skillful killing and his confidence, there was more that I was not able to explain. The more I thought about it, the more I realized that it was something in his gaze, something in the way he viewed the world. Lucid was the word that came to mind. "And what exactly is the rest?" I finally asked.
"Boundlessness," he replied. "Total commitment."
Seeing my confused face, he smiled. "It is what you have been searching for all your life without finding it. It is what we all strive for, but only few are destined to experience." He leaned back and crossed his legs.
"And you have the opportunity to be one of them."
I did not respond, knowing Kalian would not, could not, tell me more. About an hour later we arrived. The mummed coachman, who had wordlessly picked us up in the evening, opened the door, holding a piece of black cloth in his right hand. I was unable to recognize anything other than the clear light of the stars outside. Kalian took the cloth with both hands. "I am sorry, but this is necessary." I realized what he was about to do and did not resist. The cloth slipped quietly over my head and everything became pitch black. Then Kalian took my hand and guided me outside. The air I inhaled was cold. Something crunched beneath my feet when I walked. Snow.
"Come," I heard my comrade's voice, and I felt a slight pull on my left arm. I followed him.
After what I estimated to be another half an hour, I entered the Enderalian Bastion of the Libra for the first time. The echoes of our footsteps indicated that we had entered a cave of sorts. A few moments later, the sound of several other voices mingled with ours. I was told to sit down. My blindfold was removed, but I was ordered not to open my eyes before I heard the ring of a bell. "Watch closely," Kalian had whispered before the voices and footsteps faded away, and a large door was shut. Dutifully, I kept my eyes closed. A bright ringing sounded. I was in a large, round room with high walls and a dome-shaped ceiling, which struck me as the interior of a chapel. It was empty, except for numerous candlesticks with crimson flames and a symmetrical column of high and evenly spaced pillars leading to the other side. Only at second glance did I notice the painting on the walls. The painting was different to what I was used to from Enderalian temples. It did not depict the Lightborn or the 12 stages of the Pioneer's journey. It was divided into 9 different pictures. I turned my head to the left to examine the picture next to me. It showed an athletic man standing on an uneven stone road leading up a hill. He was naked except for a loincloth. The environment was barren and tundra-like, grandly lit by the bright and clear moonlight. The man had averted his gaze from the moon. He wore a simple steel mask. It had no ornamentation, only 2 narrow slits for the eyes, yet something about it fascinated me in a manner I was unable to describe. It appeared to be impeccable. Every muscle of the man's body was tensed. He held both his hands up to the sky as if he was expecting a divine blessing. I stared at the picture for an endlessly long time. It emitted something that could be described as an aura, and it elicited both joy and anxiety. Only minutes later, I spotted a small writing in the bottom right corner of the painting. I squinted my eyes to read it. The Renaissance. I kept my eyes on the picture for a few moments, frowned, and turned away. The painting was fascinating, but I had to perform a trial, even though I was not yet aware of its nature. So I looked ahead again and waited. However, nothing happened. I was starting to feel uneasy. What was expected of me? I looked uncertainly behind me. The steel door was closed. Maybe I am supposed to prove patience. I tried to calm my thoughts. I lowered my gaze and tried to meditate, as Kalian had taught me. 5 minutes passed. 10. Nothing. I felt my stomach rumble and call myself a fool because I had not eaten anything before our hasty departure. Just stretching my legs. I'm sure nobody would mind. My knees cracked while I got up. My calves tingled from sitting still for so long. Carefully and slowly I walked through the room, as if my observers would be offended by any sudden movement. I hoped for deliverance from the uncertainty by a strange, mysterious voice or the arrival of another person. It was in vain. 2 hours passed, and not even a grain of dust seemed to have moved in the sacral hall. Only then did it dawn on me that nobody was going to show up. Whatever this trial was about, I was expected to act on my own. But what was I supposed to do? I was certain that the way to passing the test did not lead through the door behind me, so I searched for a hidden clue in the room. Helplessness took root in my stomach. What was this? Some test of my willpower? Such nonsense, I thought angrily. I suppressed the urge to walk back to the door and knock. What will they do with those who do not pass the test? I had an inkling, but I was not eager to learn more about it. Kalian should have warned me, I thought with bitterness. Or he should at least have watched closely. I halted. Had it been a clue? But about what? The room was empty, except the paintings. Of course. How could I have been so blind? I considered the pictures to be a mere decoration. How could the key to this trial be hidden in them? Hastily, I turned around and stopped in front of the picture on the right side of the door. If the paintings are connected, and the left picture showing the man, the Renaissance, is the last one, then this one must be the first. I observed the painting with uncertainty. It also portrayed a man, naked, looking at the spectator. He wore a mask, just like the man in the Renaissance, and even though he was less athletic, he appeared to be the same person. The mask, however, was different. It was made from thin, skin-colored cloth, and it seemed rather like a second skin to me, tight and fissured like that of a dying old man. I averted my eyes with a feeling of disgust I could not explain, and examined the rest of the picture. At first I thought that the reflective surface on which the man stood was a floor of polished stone, but then I realized that it was still water. The area around the man was filled with wafts of mist, and only a few pine trees, drifting in the water in a surreal manner, filled the scenery. What is this supposed to mean? For a while I admired the painter's artful brushstroke. The pictures had been made with oil paint, yet they seemed strangely alive. How many artists in the world could boast such expertise?
Not many, I guessed.
Something had been written on this image as well. The limbus. My brow furrowed. Arcanists call the state of derangement after overstraining one's mental capacities the limbus. I pondered about the word, but eventually shook my head and moved on to the second image. The pictures were skillfully interwoven with each other. The second emerged from the mist in the first painting and depicted the heaven from a bird's view. The clouds were like rising smoke, drowned in sanguine light from the pale red horizon. In the center was a silhouette of a man. He hung from the sky by silken threads like a sun god's puppet, and his mouth was opened wide, as if in a scream. This picture was also titled enigmatically, The Washing. That name triggered a memory in me. Hadn't I read about a ritual with this name? Yes. I confirmed my own thought. The nomadic journey of the Kyrenians when they head off to find the Red Mountain. Before they leave, they must perform a symbolic cleansing in one of their holy rivers, allegedly to discard their former self. A new beginning, so to say, a spiritual cleansing. Could this be the meaning of the picture? I quickly look around. I was still alone. The third scene of the painting, which was similarly interwoven with the one before, showed the naked man covered in dirt and soaking wet, dragging himself to the coast, probably out of the mist-shrouded sea behind him. Its title was The First Stone. The sun shone on the man's body, and its light formed the foundation for the picture beside it, which aroused shame in me. It showed the stranded man, who now looked more athletic and nourished than in the last image, making love to a woman. His skin glazed, glistening with sweat, and splatters of blood sparkled on his chest. He wore a mask of cloth, beneath which a diabolical grin could be seen. The woman with whom the man had intercourse had her back turned to him. She was stylized in an unconventional way. Her long plaited hair hung down her back like a torrent of black pearls, and two horns emerged from her forehead. Her face remained hidden for the viewer. The couple's environment resembled a butchery. Puddles of blood shone on the floor, and a corpse lay by the man's feet. I knelt down and read the title, The First Blaze. Only when I read the last word, the scales fell from my eyes. Yes, Jail. This is a development, it shot through my head. A transformation. I had no idea whether it was by chance or by design that the man in the first painting walked through layers of fog. But there was no doubt it was me before the vision had occurred to me, when I lived in the gray drabness which I called my home, always aware how my life lagged behind my true determination in limbus. The washing was nothing short of the vision that had torn me from this life. The first stone was my escape from Fogville, and the first blaze, a cold shudder went down my spine, was my first killing. I moved on to the painting number 5. Again, the man, this time seated in front of a weathered fountain inside an overgrown temple courtyard. Instead of the cloth mask, he now wore one of razor-thin metal, but his face was still visible underneath. At his side sat a woman with fiery red hair. The picture was titled The Companion, and I instantly understood its meaning. Even though Kalian was not a woman, and our first conversation had not taken place in a beautiful ruin, it was without any doubt Kalian who had saved me from the chaos I experienced after my first encounter with the fire. For none of this is coincidental. Had Kalian known that I was a potential brother, that the fire was running through my veins? His curious gaze when I had entered the tavern suggested that this was the case. If the paintings thus far show my development, then the following ones might help me through this trial. Pushed on by the thought, I continued the examination. I suspected what the next picture would show, and my expectations were met. Its title was The Rain of Flames, and it depicted the unknown man and the red-haired woman on a battlefield. His mask appeared to me more sturdy now, and a gloomy sky, full of foreboding clouds, and only perforated by 3 dying beams of sunlight, added a cataclysmic atmosphere to the image. The man and the woman stood back to back. The woman's face expressed lust and pugnacity. Bodies covered with blood, with asymmetrical and browless faces were scattered across the ground. The image symbolized without any doubt the incident in the Undercity, Kalian's lesson. The painting to the right showed the woman holding out her hand to the man. If I had not seen the images before, I would probably have considered it gaudy. The time of rest. My heart was pounding. The parallels between the pictures and my previous experiences ended here. After the time of rest, which in a way described my apprenticeship with Kalian, I had been taken to the trial. The solution to the riddle had to be in the final two wall paintings, one of which I had already seen when I had first opened my eyes. My eyes grew heavy, and I shivered slightly as I looked at the picture which had been hidden in the shadows of the pillars. The present. The man was inside a circular room. His face was still covered by a steel mask, but in the candlelight of the hall it was clearly visible that the metal was not perfect. No, the man's face was still quite recognizable beneath, and it looked weak. A surge of disgust rose inside of me, which I could not explain. The naked man knelt in the center of the large hall, his sickly and elegiac face raised toward the ceiling of the painting, his arms limply hanging down by his sides. His body was smooth and shining, his skin covered with brown stains. What? With the realization came panic. I stared at the painting. At first I could not believe what my eyes were seeing. When I took a closer look, my doubts were erased by the accurate brush marks. I had deceived myself with my first glance. The stains covering the man's body were not brown, but red. They were not mud or grime, but blood. A horizontal cut had opened the man's throat, and blood poured down his chest. Now I noticed a small item on his left, which had undoubtedly slipped from his weak hand, a dagger. Instinctively, I averted my face and stepped back. No, I thought. No. No further reflections were necessary to comprehend the painting's message. I was expected to kill myself. It is hard to tell what I felt at that moment. I was almost hesitant to strip myself naked like my oil paint alter ego, but after a moment of pondering, I did. I had to. By no means did I want to kneel in the center of the room, like a believer expecting a blessing, but I did. Never in my life had I experienced more anxiety. I raised a dagger to my throat. My inner ear heard a disgusting tearing sound, supplied by the memory of the first killing. No. No man in his right mind would have used a knife on himself, with shaking hands, closed eyes, his body coated with cold sweat, his eyes closed like a child who tries to wake from a nightmare. However, a man in his right mind would not have followed the vision. A man in his right mind would have accepted the punishment in the stables, wandering off with a few bruises and ruptures. And no man in his right mind was chosen by the Black Libra. I squeezed my eyes further shut and clenched my shaking hand around the hilt of the weapon. In that moment, I wanted nothing more than to wake up from this ludicrous nightmare, to let the cold steel fall to the ground, to stand up and escape, somehow. Boundlessness. I sliced. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Enderal, The Butcher of Ark, Volume 8, Masks.
That's just how he is, always talking about.
Mead, stew, roast pork.